الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على رسوله الأمين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. أما بعد، هذا هو الدرس السادس الأخير بإذن الله في شرح أصول السنة للإمام الحميدي رحمه الله تعالى، وتوقفنا عند قوله: وألا نقول كما قالت الخوارج: من أصاب كبيرة فقد كفر. ونريد أن نعرف الكبيرة، تعريف الكبيرة حتى تميز بينها وبين غيرها.
بسم الله، الحمد لله، والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا. ما بعد، so our noble brother حفظه الله، he mentioned after praising Allah سبحانه وتعالى that this will be the sixth session, sixth class, and the last inshallah ta'ala in the explanation of the foundations of the creed, usul sunnah by Imam al-Humaydi rahimahullah. He said we stopped at the point that from the our aqidah, from our creed, the creed that is sound and the creed of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, that we do not say what the Khawarij say. As they say, the Khawarij, whoever fall into a major sin has disbelieved. He says, so therefore, inshallah ta'ala, to make this matter clear, let us first give you a definition and say something about what is a major sin, so that we'll be able to differentiate between it and the other sins.
الكبيرة عرفها العلماء هي كل ما جاء فيه حد في الدنيا أو وعيد في الآخرة أو ترتب عليه لعنة أو غضب أو نفي إيمان.
As for the kabira, the major sin has been defined by the scholars, our noble scholars, it is all that those sins that you will find there is a punishment, prescribed punishment for them in this life, or a threat in Yawm al-Qiyamah. Those who fall into the sin, they are threatened with a punishment in Yawm al-Qiyamah. Or also there is a curse. Allah cursed such people for doing such things, or the anger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as well is associated with such sin. All that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala denied the iman for so and so did this, he's not a believer, the one who did this and this. Nah.
مقترف الذنوب سواء كنا كبائر أو صغائر فهو لا يكفر إلا باستحلالها، إلا باستحلالها. ومن أدلة عدم كفر فاعل الكبيرة إقامة الحدود، إقامة الحدود، قطع يد السارق، جلد الزاني البكر إلى غير ذلك. فإقامة الحدود من أدلة عدم ردته وكفره، لأن المرتد حكمه غير حكم صاحب الكبيرة، ولو كان صاحب الكبيرة مرتدا لحكم عليه بالقتل. هذا من أدلة تفريق الدين الإسلام بين المرتد وبين فاعل الكبيرة.
نعم. He says, As for those who wrong themselves by falling into sins, whether those sins are major or minor sins, is not considered as a disbeliever, except with one condition. If a person thinks that it is permissible for him to commit those sins, major or minor. From the proofs, the many proofs that the person who falls into major sin is not a kafir, is not a disbeliever, we have the establishments of the prescribed punishments by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for such major sins in this dunya, such as the cutting off of the hand of the thief and the flogging of the fornicator or the adulterer. He says, in this case, we have this adillah that are clear that the person who fall into these major sins, they didn't apostate from the deen. Because the one who apostate, his ruling differ from the ruling of the one who fall into a major sin. Of course, there's lesser than shirk. If the person who fall into this major sin is considered as an apostate, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will, the ruling will be in this beautiful deen of Islam, that person should be executed and killed. But this beautiful deen of Islam make clear distinction between the one who apostated and the one who fall into a major sin.
Al-Qur'an والسنه دلتا على ان صاحب الكبيره لا يكفر بل يوصف قد يكون ممن يفعل الكبيره ويوصف بانه عنده ايمان يوصف بانه عنده ايمان قد جاء في سورة الحجرات ما يدل على ذلك في قول الله عز وجل وإن طائفتان من المؤمنين اقتتلوا فأصلحوا بينهما ثم قال سبحانه وتعالى بعد ذلك إنما المؤمنون إخوة فأصلحوا بين أخويكم فوصفهم الله عز وجل بالإيمان مع أنهم يقتتلون فما زال عنهم مع أن القتال كبيرة من الكبائر كبيرة من الكبائر مع ذلك ما زال عنهم الإيمان ما زال عنهم الإيمان وصفهم بالإيمان ومثل ذلك في السنة الرجل الذي كان يؤتى به في الخمر أو كان يأتي للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فيقول طهرني فيطهره النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وفي الحديث قال أحد الصحابة لعنه الله ما أكثر ما يؤتى به في الخمر فقال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لا تعينوا الشيطان على أخيكم والله لا أعلم منه إلا أنه يحب الله ورسوله
He says the Quran and the Sunnah there are proofs in them that the one who falls into a major sin is not a disbeliever, does not leave Islam. But the one who actually falls into a major sin, it is still mentioned that he have iman in the Quran. For instance, in Surah Al-Hujurat, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِن طَائِفَتَانِ مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ اقْتَتَلُوا When two parties from among the believers, they fight one another. So bring reconciliation between them, islah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said after that, indeed the believers are nothing but brothers one to another, so rectify the matters of your brothers. He said Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned them with iman, that they are believers even though they fight in one another. And we know that fighting here in this case is a kabira from the major sins. Likewise, an example from the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the example of that man, who he always used to come to the Prophet ﷺ many times, or they brought him sometimes drunk. But that man, he came to the Prophet ﷺ and says, purify me, meaning by establishing the punishment, prescribed punishment for the one who drinks intoxicants and the like. So much so that he comes often In that case, so much so that one of the companions says, "May the curse of Allah be upon this person." Many times he is brought for the same reason, for being drunk. But the Prophet ﷺ, he said, "Do not assist and aid the shaitan against your brother." All I know about him, that he, meaning the man who comes always drunk, he loves Allah and his messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam.
وهنا أنبه في هذا الحديث أنبه على أنه كثير ما يؤتى به في الخمر. فهذا يدلنا على أن كثرة الفعل لا يدل على الاستحلال كما تقول الخوارج.
He says, now I want to draw your attention still in this story of this man, in this hadith, that they used to bring him many times, a lot of times, while being intoxicant and under the influence of khamar and the like. He says, this is a proof that even if a person commit that same major sins many times, it doesn't mean that he consider it halal and permissible for him to do it, as it is the opinion that the khawarij are upon, وَالْعِيَادُ بِاللَّهِ.
إقامة الحدود عند أهل السنة والجماعة هي زواجر وجوابر. زواجر تزجر الناس وتخوفهم على أن يقدموا على أن لا يقدموا على هذا الفعل، وهي جوابر أنها كفارة لهذا الذي حد. بخلاف الخوارج والمعتزلة ومن نحى نحوهم، فإنهم يعتقدون أن الحدود أنها زواجر وليست جوابر، وهذا خلاف معتقد السنة والجماعة.
He says, now as for the establishment of those prescribed punishments on the sinners and those who fall into those sins that there is in our legislation, walhamdulillah, a prescribed punishment for them. As for the understanding and the aqidah of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, that those prescribed punishments for such people, they have two purposes. One for the society, that those who they see when a person, for example, steal or do this or that, and the punishment of Allah is applied on them, then they will be frightened and they will like think about it before they do it. Meaning that if he does it, then that's what's going to happen to him. And alhamdulillah, it's good for him and for the society. Likewise, it is jawabir, meaning is the expiation for that person who committed that sin. As opposed, the opinion and the creed actually of the khawarij and the mu'tazila, who they believe that those punishments are only zawajir, only to frighten the people not to fall into these things, not the case that they are a means of expiation for that person bad action. I need another pen. This one is difficult. أي هذا أحسن. تفضل جزاك الله خير. صعب هذا لا يتلائم مع الورق. إخوان, if you can move and fill the gaps, I mean like the spots, because your brothers are still coming. جزاكم الله خيرا. بارك الله فيكم. Okay. And also the brothers over here, if you come, there is on the other side, there is some room, inshallah. Okay. Now.
كذلك النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم لما أقام الحدود على بعض الصحابة مدحهم بعد إقامة الحد عليهم. فمثلا ماعز رضي الله عنه قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم: لقد تاب توبة لو وزعت على أهل الدنيا لوسعتهم. وقال في الغامدية أيضا: لقد تابت توبة لو وزعت على أهل المدينة لوسعتهم. وهذا لا يكون في حال الكفار. لو كانوا مرتدين عياذا بالله، كانوا كفرة بفعلهم، لما نفعتهم التوبة، لما نفعتهم التوبة ولما مدحهم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم.
If somebody wants to take care of that, inshallah, Zakum Allah khair from the administration. Barakallahu feekum.
Nah.
Sometimes it says they cannot hear because they, some people are talking too. Nah. Allahu a'lam. Our noble Shaykh Hafidhahu Ta'ala, he says, likewise, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he established the hudud, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has established this, the some of the punishment, this prescribed punishment on some of the companions. Na'am, but after that he has praised them and said good things about them. Na'am, for instance, Ma'iz radiyallahu anhu. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that Ma'iz has repented. And his repentance was good for him, that if he was to be divided on all the people of earth, it will benefit them. Likewise, another example, the woman Al-Ghamidiyya. Likewise, after she was stoned and she died, but the Prophet ﷺ, he said that her tawbah, that repentance that she had, sincere repentance, if he were to be divided on the people of Medina, it will suffice them and will benefit them. He says, now the Prophet is praising them and talking about their tawbah and the like. This is not for the kuffar. If they were kuffar as the khawarij and the like they claim they are, or they apostate with those actions they have perpetrated, the tawbah would be of no benefit for them. And the Prophet certainly would not praise them after that.
Wal khawarij fahimu من بعض النصوص الشرعية فهما خاطئا، ولا غرابة في ذلك، لأن الذي لا يعود إلى فهم الصحابة ولا إلى فهم العلماء فإنه يضل. هذا شيء ليس بغريب أبدا. فهؤلاء فهموا من بعض الأحاديث التي فيها نفي دخول الجنة، مثل لا يدخل الجنة قاطع رحم، لا يدخل الجنة نمام، إلى غير ذلك من الأحاديث التي جاء فيها عدم دخول الجنة لمن فعل كبيرة، فقالوا إذن هو من المخلدين في النار. وهذا خلاف الصواب، لأن أهل السنة والجماعة لا يأخذون دينهم من حديث واحد، ولا يفهمون الدين كله من حديث واحد، بل يجمعون بين الأدلة، خاصة وهناك أحاديث تدل على دخوله، وهناك آيات تدل على مغفرة الله عز وجل وتوبة الله لمن جاء بذنب دون الشرك. والجمع أولى من الترجيح، والإعمال أولى من الإهمال. إعمال الأدلة، إعمال الأدلة كلها أولى من ترك بعضها. فالعلماء نظروا إلى هذه الأحاديث فقالوا هذه أحاديث وعيد، وهناك أحاديث وعد، من قال لا إله إلا الله دخل الجنة. فقالوا إذن لابد من الجمع بين الأحاديث. الجمع هو قول الله عز وجل إن الله لا يغفر أن يشرك به ويغفر ما دون ذلك لمن يشاء، وأن دخول الجنة هناك من يدخل أوليا وهناك من يعذب ويدخل الجنة بعد ذلك. هناك من يعذب ثم يدخل الجنة. فهؤلاء أهل التوحيد الذين جاءوا بالتوحيد كاملا ولم ينقصوه ولم يخدشوه، وكذلك أيضا ابتعدوا عن الشوائب، ابتعدوا عن النواقض والنواقص، وهو تصفية التوحيد وتنقيته من شوائب الشرك والبدع والمعاصي. فمن جاء بهذه فإن له الأمن التام، فيدخل الجنة بلا يدخل الجنة أوليا. وهذا هو مصداق قول الله عز وجل: الذين آمنوا ولم يلبسوا إيمانهم بظلم أولئك لهم الأمن. قال العلماء: الأمن التام، لهم الأمن التام، وهو دخول الجنة أوليا. الذين نقوا توحيدهم وأعمالهم من شوائب البدع الشرك والبدع والمعاصي. أما من نقى عمله من الشرك ووقع في بعض البدع دون البدع المكفرة ووقع في المعاصي، فإنه تحت المشيئة، إن شاء الله عذبه وإن شاء غفر له، إن شاء عذبه وإن شاء غفر له، لقول الله عز وجل: إن الله لا يغفر أن يشرك به ويغفر ما دون ذلك لمن يشاء. فإذا مرتكب الكبيرة عند أهل السنة والجماعة هو تحت المشيئة، وهذا الذي يقال له صاحب الأمن الناقص. إذا الأمن التام دخول الجنة بلا أوليا، دخول الجنة أوليا، وصاحب الأمن الناقص هو دخول الجنة يعني بعد أن يعذب إذا أراد الله عز وجل، وإلا غفر له، مثل حديث البطاقة الذي يعني صاحب السجلات، فإن الله عز وجل غفر له، غفر له لأنه تحت المشيئة. والرجل الذي قتل 99 نفس غفر له سبحانه وتعالى.
Now to highlight the problem that the Khawarij, why they fall into this, why they oppose the Aqidah of Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, because they didn't have the correct understanding of some of the texts of the legislation, whether in the Quran or in the Sunnah of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. They have an understanding that is wrong. He says, and you shouldn't be amazed why they fall into this, because the one who do not refer back to the understanding of the companions, the one who do not and refer to what the ulama of the Salaf says, such person he will be misguided, no doubt. So then, the Khawarij and those who follow them on this path, this wicked path, they understood from those texts, the ahadith, in which the Prophet ﷺ says, for instance, he would not enter Jannah, the one who cut the ties of kinship. He would not enter Jannah, an-namam, the one who goes around with transmitting statements of these people to the others in a way to cause fitna and turmoil and chaos, from many other narrations. Then they understood from it that this person would not enter Jannah, period. Ayna'am. But Ahlus Sunnah, they mentioned that this man has committed a major sin. But the Khawarij, for instance, they say, no, this person will be from the dwellers of the hellfire. And this is opposed clearly, and with no doubt whatsoever, the correct opinion that Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they have. And that is because Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they do not take their religion nor their understanding of a matter from one narration, but rather they look in any field, in any chapter of the deen, they gather all of the adillah, all of the proof pertaining to that matter. Yes, there is this hadith that, for example, they says the one who does such and such thing will not enter the Jannah, but then there is so many other texts in the Quran and Sunnah That talks about the maghfirah of Allah. That Allah forgive to such people because they are upon Iman, upon Islam, and they say La ilaha illallah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive their sins. For those people who they commit major sins that are lesser than shirk. So he said, so combining between the adillah and bring them together, it's better than just taking one hadith and therefore building an opinion or a ruling based on one hadith. The ulama of Ahlul Sunnah al-Jama'ah, they do not just focus on a particular hadith or a dalil and a proof and neglect the rest. Now this is the case of Ahlul Bid'ah, what dalal, like the Khawarij. So here in this case, Ahlul Sunnah al-Jama'ah, when they faced with a hadith like this, there is a severe warning against certain people who commit certain sins. They say, but there is other ahadith. There is other ahadith, such as whoever says La ilaha illallah will enter al-Jannah. So they will combine, and in the light, they look at the ayah, that famous ayah we heard many times in decision in Surah An-Nisa. Allah does not forgive a person who commits shirk, died upon shirk and met Allah with shirk, but he forgives subhanahu wa ta'ala anything lesser than shirk to whom he wills. So the Shaykh, he mentioned a point that is very important. He says, now for the people to enter al-Jannah, na'am, from the muwahideen, those who die upon tawheed, there are those who they will enter straight to the Jannah without any punishment. But then there is other people, yes, they may be punished by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and then after that they will be admitted to the Jannah, into the Jannah, paradise. But now he says, for those people who they were upon tawheed, and they were serious, and they were diligent, and they protect and preserve their tawheed, they understood what is tawheed, Islam, monotheism, and they preserve it from anything that may nullify it or tarnish it with anything, since from the actions of bid'ah. Of course, he says the bid'ah does not from the category of those innovations that take a person out of Islam. They stay away from the things that take away from the completion of tawheed, such as sins that are lesser than shirk and the like. But rather, these people, they protect their tawheed from shirk, and they protect themselves, their tawheed from the bid'ah innovations and from sins. These people, they have the complete amen and security, and they will enter al-Jannah straight away. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, those who believe and do not mix their iman with dhulm, shirk, for such people the complete security and aman. The ulama, they says, this complete aman, meaning they will enter al-Jannah without any punishment. As for the person who they were deficient in their actions, and they protect their tawheed from shirk and from the innovations that are in the category of disbelief. But yes, they may fall into some innovations that are lesser than that category, and also some sins. Such people, they will be under the mashi'ah, the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if they die upon tawheed, but while they wrong themselves with major sins, with minor sins, fall into some bid'ah that do not take person out of Islam, they will be under the will of Allah on Yawm al-Qiyamah. If Allah wishes to punish them, they will be punished. If Allah wants to forgive them and allow them in Jannah, in the light of the ayah, verily Allah does not forgive for those who meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon shirk, but He forgive anything else from the sins that are less than shirk to whom He wills. So He says, so therefore, the belief of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, the aqidah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, that such a person, it will be under the mashiach of Allah. And this is that the ulama, they mentioned, the aman on Yawm al-Qiyamah for such a person is deficient, is not complete. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wish to punish them for the sins that they have perpetrated, and then they will be admitted to the Jannah. But if Allah wants to forgive them, and they will not be punished, period, into the Jannah, Allah does what He will subhanahu wa ta'ala. And He gave two examples. The example, the famous hadith of the man that is called the man of the bitaqa, the man who came with 99 scrolls of sins. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said, you have one hasana, it was one index card, the bitaqa, that's in it, La ilaha illallah, tawheed. Allah forgives such a person. Likewise, the man who killed 99 people and followed with the monk and they make him 100, we know in that hadith that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has forgiven that person. Now.
أيضا من أعظم أسباب هذا الضلال الذي ضل به الخوارج والمعتزلة وكذلك المرجئة أنهم يعتقدون أن الإيمان لا يزيد ولا ينقص، بل يعتقدون أنه واحد، كتلة واحدة، إذا ذهب بعضه ذهب كله، إذا ذهب بعضه ذهب كله. ولذلك عندما تقول الإيمان يزيد وينقص هذا في رد على ثلاثة طوائف: الخوارج والمعتزلة والمرجئة. فالخوارج يرون أن ذهاب البعض يدل على ذهاب الكل، فعندما مثلا حديث لا يزني الزاني حين يزني وهو مؤمن، قالوا إذن هو كافر. ليش؟ لأنهم جعلوا الإيمان شيء واحد ما يزيد ولا ينقص، ما قالوا لا يزني وهو مؤمن. المقصود الإيمان الواجب الذي يردعه عن مثل هذا الفعل، بل قالوا يرتفع كله إذن يكفر. وهنا مسألة ذكرتها لكم في مسألة الزيادة والنقصان، أن الذي يزيد وينقص هو ما فوق أصل الإيمان. الخوارج يرون أن الذي ينقص ينقص الأصل، ولذلك هم يكفرون، يقولون أن الأصل هو الذي ينقص. وأما أهل السنة والجماعة يقولون لا، ينقص الإيمان الواجب والمستحب حتى يصل إلى الأصل، فإذا نقص في الأصل هذا كفر، وهذا لا يكون إلا بالكفر بالله عز وجل، وهذا لا يكون باقتراف الذنوب دون الشرك. فإذا ننتبه لهذا المسلك الخطير، فسبب تكفيرهم هو أنهم لا يرون الزيادة والنقصان. المرجئة جاءوا يريدون أن يردون على الخوارج، لذلك حدثوا بعد الخوارج، قالوا لا هو كامل الإيمان، وكلاهما على باطل، والصحيح أنه يزيد وينقص، يزيد وينقص، هذا هو الصحيح. فهذا الذي يقول هو كامل دائما باطل، والذي يقول هو ناقص دائما باطل، والصحيح أنه يزيد وينقص. هذا باختصار.
Likewise, from the great means that lead these people to be deviated and upon the upon misguidance, such as the Khawarij and the Mu'tazila. Likewise, the Murji'ah. These are three deviant sects: Khawarij, Mu'tazila, and Murji'ah. For example, the Murji'ah, they believe that the iman does not decrease and does not increase, but it is one thing. If some of it is gone, the entire iman is gone with it. Is gone with it. So that's why they don't say that iman increases and decreases. And but Ahlus Sunnah wal Jama'ah, when they say that iman increases and decreases, by saying this and this aqidah is a refutation against three deviant sects: the Khawarij and the Mu'tazila and the Murji'ah. As for the Khawarij, who they say when a person commits a major sin, that's it, his iman is gone completely. Like for example, this is how they understand the hadith. When the Prophet ﷺ says, the fornicator, he's not upon iman when he committed that sin. The Khawarij, they say he's a kafir, so he's not a believer, is it? He's a kafir. They don't say, wait, what iman we're talking about here? Asl al-Iman, we look at the iman of the pillars, six pillars of iman, or the completion of the iman. He has a problem, his iman is not complete, and he's falling into certain things that take away and diminish from his iman al-wajib or the mustahab. He says, As we mentioned to you in the previous class, when Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, they talk about the Iman that increases and decreases, they're not talking about Asl al-Iman. They're not talking about the Iman of Allah, for example. Iman of the angels and the light. This does not, you cannot say that Iman in Allah increase, decrease. Because if it decreases, that's a big problem. That's kufr al-iyad billah. But they're talking about the things that complete one's Iman. The thing that you do beyond the asl. But the asl should not change. You have to believe in Allah. You don't believe in Allah in some percentage. You gotta believe in Allah as according to the aqidah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. So, the Murji'ah who came after the Khawarij. Now they want to refute the Khawarij. They want to say the Khawarij are wrong. And they say, La, the Iman of a person is complete. Never decrease or increase. That's the belief of the Khawarij. If a person, the Murji'ah, Afwan, if a person is a believer, he's a believer. His Iman is complete. He says both of them are wrong. But the Sahih is that the Iman in the Aqidah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, that Iman increases and decreases, but as we mentioned to you, inshaAllah ta'ala. Na'am.
هنا مسألة وهي نظرة أهل السنة والجماعة لأهل الكبائر. ما هي نظرتهم لهم؟ نظرتهم لهم بأنهم يحبون من وجه ويبغضون من وجه. يحبون لأنهم من المسلمين ويبغضون لأفعالهم. ويبغضون لأفعالهم. وهذا أيضا من الأمور التي يفارق أهل السنة الخوارج والمعتزلة، فإنهم يفارقوهم، لأن الخوارج يقولون، يقول الخوارج لا نستطيع أن نتصور أن شخص يحب من وجه ويبغض من وجه، ما نستطيع أن نتصور هذا، يا إما تحبه يا إما تبغضه، وهذا باطل. هناك أشياء موجودة تحبها وتكرهها، أو تحب شيئا منها أو تحبها من وجه وتبغضها من وجه، أشياء موجودة، مثل قال العلماء مثل الشيب. الشيب مكروه، ما تحب أن ترى الشيب في رأسك في لحيتك، لكنه من وجه مكروه. ليش؟ لأنك مبغوض، لأنك يقربك إلى الموت. لكنه محبوب من وجه، أنك تبقى يعني في هذا الشيب خير من أن تموت. لو قيل لك تبقى في هذا الشيب وما تموت فإنه تحب، يعني الإنسان يكون شايب وحي أفضل له من أن يكون يعني أن يقر أن يموت. إذن يرضى بهذا ويحبه. ولذلك قال الشاعر: الشيب كره وكره أن أفارقه، الشيب كره وكره أن أفارقه، فاعجب بشيء على البغضاء محبوب. الشيب كره وكره أن أفارقه، فاعجب لشيء على البغضاء محبوب. يعني تبغضه وأيضا تحبه، تبغضه لأنه يقربك إلى الموت، وتحبه لأنك يعني تكون شايب ولا تموت، يعني أفضل. لو قيل لشخص مثلا تكون ما تشيب لكن تموت يعني وأنت شباب، لا، يقول لك لا، أريد أن حتى أشيب وحتى يعني أكبر. فإذا يجتمع البغض، يعني وهذا البيت حفظته من شيخنا الشيخ ابن محسن عباد، يعني دائما يذكره. فعموما هناك أشياء، وهناك أشياء كثيرة، مثل زوجتك غير المسلمة، زوجتك غير المسلمة تحبها من وجه وتبغضها من وجه. تحبها لأنها زوجة، لابد الإنسان يحب زوجته سواء كان مسلمة أو غير مسلمة، كيف يعاشرها، كيف يعني يسكن معه، لابد أن يكون في بينهم محبة. والدين ما نهاك أن تحب زوجتك الغير مسلمة، ما نهاك، لكن يجب أن تبغض دينها، فأنت تبغضها لدينها وتحبها لعشرتها وزواجك منها. نعم.
There's a matter that it has to be clear for all of us that how أهل السنة والجماعة look at the people who fall into major sins that are less than shirk. He says أهل السنة والجماعة how they look at the people, the Muslims, who fall into major sins, they love them from one side and they hate them from the other. How is that? They love them because they're still Muslims. Yeah, commit a sin, major sin, but the person's still a Muslim. That's why they love them, because they're still a Muslim. But they hate their actions. Those despicable actions that they fall into, they hate them for that. He says, and this is something that Al-Khawarij and the Mu'tazila, they oppose Ahl-Sunnah in this matter as well. Many points of Aqidah, they oppose Ahl-Sunnah or Jama'ah. The Khawarij, they say, they cannot perceive nor even think or imagine that a person can be loved and hated at the same time. They say, look, it's one thing. Whether you love a person or you hate a person. As for go two ways, they said this can't be. And this is batil, this is falsehood, this is wrong. He says, "Nam." For example, he said, there are certain things in ordinary life you like, and you, in the same time, you may hate about the same thing. For example, gray hair. It is disliked because a person, whenever he look at himself and see the gray, like, man, I'm getting old, I'm getting close to death. They don't like that. But then they love it from another way, that like, I'm still alive. There are people that are younger than me. There are other people, they die, and they're younger than me. I'm still alive. And if he was given the choice to choose to die while young with no gray hair, or to live longer with a gray hair, certainly will choose life over death. And he mentions some of the a line of poetry. He says that he has memorized from our noble Sheikh Al-Allama, Al-Muhaddith, Abd al-Muhsin, Al-Badr, حفظه الله تعالى ومتعه بالصحة والعافية وغفر له ولوالديه والمسلمين والمسلمات. That about shape, about the gray hair. You may dislike it, but you dislike to let it go. So he said it's amazing how you can hate something, but you like it from another sense. He says, so therefore, the same way as he mentioned, if a person was to be given a choice, which is just an example, whether to live while longer while having gray hair or to die as a young person, of course, person will choose life over death. So therefore, yes, this is something that can happen, inshallah ta'ala. Another example, he says, a person, a Muslim, married to a non-Muslim woman. She's a Christian, for example, from the people of the book. He says, Naam, that husband, he loved his wife because that's normal. Islam did not prohibit such things. This is how you're going to have a good life with her and harmony and the like, by loving her. But in the same time, you hate her religion. You hate the battle that she's upon now.
كذلك أهل السنة والجماعة، وأختم بهذا هذه المسألة، أهل السنة والجماعة يخافون على المسيء ويرجون له، يخافون على المسيء ويرجون له، ويرجون للمطيع ويخافون عليه. هذه عقيدة أهل السنة في المطيع وفي العاصي، في المسيء وفي المحسن، أنهم يخافون على العاصي ويرجون له، يخافون عليه عقاب الله عز وجل ويرجون له مغفرة الله عز وجل وثوابه، لأننا لا نشهد لأحد بجنة أو نار في هذه الدنيا إلا لمن شهد لهم النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم وما شهد لهم الله سبحانه وتعالى وهم الكفار. أما المسلم ما تشهد له لا بجنة ولا بنار. فإذا المسيء نخاف عليه ونرجو له، المحسن نرجو له ونخاف عليه، لعل الذي فعلها رياء ما ندري. ولذلك هذا هو المعتقد الصحيح، هذا هو المعتقد الصحيح التي يعني تدل عليه الأدلة الصحيحة الصريحة.
Likewise, we should understand that it's from the Aqidah of Ahlus-Sunnah al-Jama'ah. They fear for the one who wronged himself with sins, but in the same time, they hope for him that Allah forgive his sins. But in the same time, the one who's doing good and righteous and upright, the one who chose righteousness over wickedness and the like, they hope that Allah will reward him and the like, but in the same time, they are afraid for that person. He's going to mention why later on. He said, this is the aqidah, the creed, and the belief of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah, as it related to the one who is righteous and the one who still a Muslim, alhamdulillah, but wrong himself with sins. That the one who's wronging himself with sins, they are afraid for that person from the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because there is punishment prescribed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for those who wrong themselves and disobey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But at the same time, they hope that Allah will forgive such a person and accept their repentance. It is one of the points also from the Aqidah of Ahlus-Sunnah al-Jama'ah that in this life, we do not witness for anyone that he is from the people of Jannah or from the people of the hellfire, except for those that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has mentioned they are from the people of Jannah or from the people of the hellfire or His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. For example, the kuffar, if they die upon kufr, Allah said they are from the people of the hellfire. As for us, this is how the aqidah of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah is. The one who chooses righteousness, alhamdulillah, and they diligent and they careful and they are righteous and upright and they choose obedience over disobedience, na'am, we hope for them that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reward them as Allah promised them the great rewards, but in the same time you're afraid for them that their action may be tarnished or mixed with shawaf, for example. This is the correct aqidah of Ahlul Sunnah al-Jama'ah that is based on clear and sound proofs.
ثم قال رحمه الله تعالى ولا نكفر بشيء من الذنوب، وهذا يعني مقصوده دون الشرك، لا نكفر بشيء من الذنوب دون الشرك، لأنه يرد على الخوارج، كما قال الإمام الطحاوي رحمه الله تعالى ولا نكفر أحدا من أهل القبلة، لا نكفر أحدا من أهل القبلة بذنب ما لم يستحله، إذا استحله فإنه يكفر. عقيدة السنة الجماعة كل الذنوب دون الشرك فإن فعلها لا يكفر الإنسان بها وإن أكثر من ذلك، لكن إذا استحل فإنه يكفر وإن لم يفعل، إذا استحل فإنه يكفر وإن لم يفعل. إنسان عياذا بالله عاذني الله وإياكم من ذلك، إنسان يشرب الخمر ليل ونهار ولكن يعتقد أنها حرام لا يكفر، وإنسان ما يشرب الخمر ويقول أنا لا أشربها لأنها سيئة لكن ليست حرام، فإن هذا كافر عياذا بالله، لأنه استحل ما حرم الله وإن لم يقارف هذا الأمر وإن لم يفعل هذا الأمر.
So Imam Al-Humaydi rahimahu ta'ala says, and we do not consider as disbelievers anyone who commit these sins, meaning the major sins that are, he said, meaning what is intended here, the major sins that are lesser than shirk. And of course, he's still refuting the Khawarij. He says, as Al-Imam Al-Tahawi rahimahu ta'ala says, we do not deem and consider as a disbelievers, anyone from the people of Qibla, in the Muslims, who commit a sin, a major sin, that is lesser than shirk, unless if that person deemed that and believed that that sin is halal, is permissible for him to do that. Naam, if a person consider a sin to be lawful to do, then that's a kufr, waliyadu billah, a disbelief. He says, all of the sins, all of them, any type of sin that is lesser than shirk, when a person committed it, does not become disbeliever. It doesn't matter if you do it many times, unless if that person considered it to be lawful, in this time is considered a disbeliever, even if that person didn't even commit that sin. He gave an example. He said, and we seek refuge with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from such things. He said, there is a person who drinks khamr, alcohol, intoxicant, day and night. You know, our term is an addict, you know, alcoholic or whatever. But he believed, while he's perpetrating this haram, he believed that this is haram. Yeah, he drinks, but he knows it's haram in the deen of Allah. That person is not a disbeliever. But then there is another person who do not drink, for example, alcohol, beverages. But he say the reason why he doesn't drink, it's bad and not healthy and the like, but it's not haram. It's not haram. This person is a kafir. Even he didn't drink, not even a cup. The Shaykh didn't say a cup, so no way that come from.
Naam. ثم قال رحمه الله تعالى إنما الكفر في ترك الخمس التي قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم بني الإسلام على خمس: شهادة أن لا إله إلا الله، وأن محمدا رسول الله، وإقام الصلاة، وإيتاء الزكاة، وصوم رمضان، وحج البيت. المصنف رحمه الله تعالى قال إنما الكفر في ترك الخمس، أي أن الكفر يكون بترك هذه الخمس مجتمعة. إذا ترك الخمس مجتمعة فقد هدم الإسلام كله، لأن الشهادتين ما يدخل إنسان الإسلام إلا بالشهادتين. لا يدخل إنسان المسلم، لا يدخل الإسلام إلا بالشهادتين. فإذا ترك هذه الخمس هذا هو الكافر. يريد أن يرد على الخوارج الذين يكفرون بترك يعني بفعل الذنوب، بفعل الذنب، يقول لهم أنه ليس بفعل الذنب دون الشرك. ما في ذنب يكفر الإنسان به إلا إذا استحل، وهذا باتفاق. لكن في التروك إذا ترك، إنما الكفر في ترك الخمس. والخمس مقصود بها المباني الخمس التي جاءت في هذا الحديث: بني الإسلام على خمس، فإن تركها كاملة كفر بالإجماع. إن تركها كاملة كفر بالإجماع. نعم.
Then Imam al-Humaydi رحمه الله تعالى, he says, rather it is considered as a disbelief when a person leave off the five that the Prophet said about them. Islam is built upon five, which is to bear witness that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah, and to bear witness that Muhammad is his servant and messenger, and to establish the prayers, to give the zakat, to fast in the month of Ramadan, and to perform the hajj for those who have the ability to do so. He says here, the author, Imam al-Humaydi rahimahullah, he says that the disbelief, or a person falling into disbelief, if he live off these five. Meaning, he says, if he abandon all of them together, all of these five together, because this person has destroyed the Islam, because Islam is built upon these five things. He said, keep in mind that no one enters the Islam unless and until they utter these statements of the Shahadatain, to bear witness that none has the right to be worshipped except Allah, and that Muhammad is his servant and messenger, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If a person leave off these five pillars here, this is the person who is a kafir. So here, once again, الإمام الحميدي in the عقيدة of أهل السنة والجماعة by highlighting these points, he's still refuting the Khawarij, who they, as we learned previously, they consider a person who fall into a major sin that is lesser than shirk as a disbeliever. Now he said, what you should understand, if that, the ulama, they mention, if a person live off these five pillars together, does not perform any one of them, this is a consensus of the ulama, that this person is a disbeliever. Now.
ثم قال رحمه الله تعالى وأما ثلث منها فلا يناظر تاركه من لم يتشهد ولم يصلي ولم يصم لأنه لا يؤخر من هذا شيء عن وقته لأنه لا يؤخر من هذا شيء عن وقته ولا يجزئ من قضاه بعد تفريطه فيه عامدا عن وقته ثلث يعني ثلث المباني الخمسة لا يناظر تاركه لا يناظر تاركه وهما أولا من لم يتشهد يعني من لم يقول أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأن محمد رسول الله فإنه كافر بإجماع العلماء لقول النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أمرت أن أقاتل الناس حتى يقولوا لا إله إلا الله فإن هذا يدل على أيضا فإن قالوها فقد عصموا مني الحديث قال ولم يصلي من لم يتشهد ولم يصلي ولم يصم إما أن يكون الإمام رحمه الله تعالى يكون مقصوده يعني إذا لم يفعل هذه الأمور الثلاثة مجتمعة فإن هذا يكفر وهذا لا شك أنه يكفر ولكن إذا كان يقصد أيضا متفرقة جاء بالشهادتين ولم يأتي بالصلاة أو جاء بالشهادتين والصلاة ولم يأتي بالصيام فهذا أيضا مذهب لبعض العلماء التكفير بباقي الأركان الأربعة التكفير لتارك الأركان الأربعة هو قول لبعض العلماء قال ولم يصلي وتعرفون الخلاف في ترك الصلاة هل هو كافر أو لا والخلاف فيه ليس خلافا حادثا بل هو قديم جدا بل هو قديم بين السلف لاختلافهم في فهم النصوص أو دلالات النصوص هل يقصد بها الترك بالكلية أو المقصود بها تكاسلا ولكنهم اتفقوا جميعا من قيل له صلي وإلا قتلناك فإنه إن استحب القتل على الصلاة فإنه كافر بإجماع العلماء إذا استحب القتل على الصلاة فإنه كافر بإجماع العلماء حتى الذين لا يرون كفر تارك الصلاة حتى الذين لا يرون كفر تارك الصلاة قال ولم يصلي ولم يصم أيضا يعني هذا رأي لبعض العلماء لكنه لا شك أنه رأي مرجوح لأن الذي جاءت الأدلة عليه أنه إذا فعل ذلك استحلالا إذا فعل ذلك استحلالا فإنه لا شك أفطر في رمضان عامدا متعمدا مستحلا فإن هذا كفر أما أفطر في رمضان عامدا فإنه يجب عليه القضاء وإذا كان كافرا لا يجب عليه القضاء أصلا والأدلة تدل على قضائه وأنه لابد من القضاء قال ولم يصلي لأنه لماذا يرون كفر هذا لأنه لا يؤخر من هذا شيء عن وقته تأخير هذه الأمور هذه لها أوقات الصلاة لها أوقات إن الصلاة كانت على المؤمنين كتابا موقوتا ولا يقبل الله عز وجل صلاة في غير وقتها كذلك رمضان كما قال سبحانه وتعالى يا أيها الذين آمنوا كتب عليكم الصيام كما كتب على الذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون. وقال أيام معدودات، فإذا لها وقت لا تغير ولا تبدل إلا لحاجة وضرورة، يعني دلت عليه الأدلة. قال ولا يجزئ من قضاه بعد تفريطه فيه عامدا عن وقته. وهذا أيضا يعني في مسألة الصلاة يعني واضح، من ترك الصلاة عمدا فإن يعني من أهل العلم من يقول لا يجوز له أن يعيدها، إذا تركها عامدا متعمدا حتى خرج وقتها فإنه لا يعيدها لأنها لا تقبل منه، فهذا من يقول بكفره. ومن لا يرى كفر تارك الصلاة تكاسلا فإنه يرى عليه القضاء. ثم كذلك الصيام، كذلك الصيام. عموما خلاصة القول في هذه المسألة أنه ليس هناك ذنب يكفر العبد به في مسألة في الترك إلا الشهادتين، وأما الصلاة والصيام وغيرها من الأمور التي ستأتي فإنها مختلف فيها، وأرجح أقوال العلماء أن فيها أنه لا يكفر بالترك بمجرد الترك، وإنما يكفر بالاستحلال، استحلال الترك. نعم.
الإمام الحميدي رحمه الله تعالى says, as for three of these five, if a person does not perform them, there is no need to sit and try to establish the proof and the like. He says, for example, the one who doesn't utter the shahadatain, and the one who didn't establish the prayer, and does not fast. He said, here we understand from here, meaning that to the end of the statement of the Imam, he says, meaning here, these three of these five pillars that Islam is built upon, the one who does not perform them is not to be debated or talked to, but rather is a kafir. For example, he said, the matter is clear for the shahadatain. Someone who does not say the shahadatain, this person is a disbeliever with the consensus of the ulama. Because the Prophet ﷺ says, I will order to fight the people until they say La ilaha illallah. In another statement, if they say La ilaha illallah, so their lives and their world and the like are sacred and they say. As for now, the one who does not pray and does not fast in the month of Ramadan, how we understand this? He said, what is intended by the author here, maybe he mentioned that these three together, if someone leave off these three together, the shahadatain and the salat and the fast in the month of Ramadan, he's a kafir. He said, and this is the right opinion, by the way. But if he intended that maybe he, for example, this person, he said the shahadatain, but he didn't pray, for example, and fast, or and the like, or he said the shahadatain, but he didn't, and he fast, but he don't pray. So this is the madhab of Ahlul Sunnah wal Jama'ah. Some of them, as we know, that there is a khilaf when it comes to the one who does not pray. There is a difference of opinions among them. This is an old difference of opinion, an old matter. It's not something that just happened these days, but this is from the Salaf, as related to the one who does not pray. Is he a kafir or not? And why they have this difference of opinions? Because of their understanding of the texts, what the texts that they use, this part they use certain texts and they understood from them certain things like this. This is for the one who does not pray out of laziness, not the one who says it's not for us to pray. That's another issue. So they have a consensus that, for instance, he said, if a person said to him, this person don't pray, but they said to him, listen, whether you pray, we're giving you a choice. Al-Hakim, and this is here, of course, he points out something that is very important, that the establishment of the punishment, the prescribed punishment, is not for anybody. This is for the ruler, or the one who assigned by the ruler to deal with these matters. Okay, it's not for somebody, just somebody don't pray, take them to some dark alley and the like. It is not the deen of Allah. Okay, let's set that straight. So, for example, if the ruler who represents him, they say to this person who does not pray, listen, you choose whether you pray or we kill you. And he chooses willingly to be killed over praying. He said, that's a kafir. This person is a disbeliever with the consensus of the ulama. He said, also the author said, or he does not fast in the month of Ramadan. He said, yes, because this is one of the opinions of some of the ulama. They said that if a person does not fast in the month of Ramadan, is a kafir, even though he doesn't believe that it's halal for him not to fast and the like. But this is not the sound opinion, by the way. Unless if he thinks this is permissible for him to break the fast in the daylight of Ramadan. This is different than the case of someone who believes that, yes, he's a pillar from Islam, you gotta fast, it's obligatory to fast, but he still break the fast on purpose. This person is not a kafir. Unless if he thinks that it's halal for him, not it's not for him, it's not wajib for him to fast in the month of Ramadan. That's why you find that the ulama, they mention, and of course, in accordance to the adilla, shar'iyya from the legislation, that the one who break the fast in the month of Ramadan on purpose, then that person has to make up this expiation, he has to make up those days. And he's a sinful. Naam, he's a sinful from not fulfilling that obligation. Likewise, he says, he mentioned the salat. For example, the person who delayed the salat and doesn't perform it in the prescribed time for it by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because as in Surah Al-Nisa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us, إِنَّ الصَّلَاةَ كَانَتْ أَلْمُؤْمِنِينَ كِتَابًا مَوْقُوتًا. The well-known ayah 103, we know, alhamdulillah, is repeated many times in the books of fiqh and the like of salat, that the salat is prescribed on the believers in a fixed time. Allah is the one who fixed these times. They are fixed in the legislation of Allah. So, no, Allah does not accept the salat of a person who does not perform it in its time. Unless if that person have a valid reason that is mentioned, alhamdulillah. Likewise, the fasting of the month of Ramadan. We don't fast anyone, choose one month and fast according to his desires. No, we fast because Allah said, O you who believe, fasting in the month of Ramadan has been prescribed for you as it was prescribed for those upon you. And Allah says, in a well-known days, which is the month of Ramadan. So no one should tamper with these things. Unless if a person have a valid reason, like those people who are sick or traveling, for example, they do not fast in the Ramadan, but they still obliged to make it up if they are from those people who can make up those days. As for the matter of the salat now, the one who does not pray. If a person does not pray on purpose, he knows. It's not like Arab laziness or oversleep. No, he knows he's supposed to pray, and he didn't pray until the time expires. Some of the ulama, they says, this person is not permissible for him to make up that prayer. Because Allah would not accept it. Why? Because it is not performed as legislated by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Well, and from them, they says that a person who out of laziness did not pray in a time, because some of the ulama, there is a difference of opinion, they don't see this person to be a disbeliever, they said that person should make up those prayers. He says the summary of this point here, in this matter, that there is not a sin that make a person a disbeliever when abandoning it and not performing it and acting upon it, from these things here, except the shahadatain. Except the shahadatain. If a person does not say the shahadatain, he is not a Muslim. As for the salat, person did not, he say la ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but they have problems with the salat, they don't pray, they didn't fast and the like. This is the difference of opinions of the ulama. And the sound opinion is that a person does not become automatically disbeliever just because he didn't pray or didn't fast and the like. But the one actually who become a disbeliever is the one who thinks it is halal, lawful for him not to pray, or permissible for him not to fast and the like. Now,
ثم قال رحمه الله تعالى وأما الزكاة فمتى أداها أجزأت عنه. وكان آثما في الحبس. الزكاة لا شك أنها من أركان الإسلام، فمتى أداها أجزأت عنه، يعني لو أخرها، لو أخر فإنه يأثم يعني لغير حاجة وضرورة فإنه يأثم لذلك. قال فمتى أداها أجزأت عنه، وكان آثما بالحبس يعني في حبسها عن الفقراء، لأن الله عز وجل يقول وآتوا حقه يوم حصاده، وآتوا حقه يوم حصاده. ومن الأدلة على أن تارك الزكاة غير المستحل للترك أنه ليس بكافر ما جاء في صحيح مسلم، ما جاء في صحيح مسلم أن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم أنه قال ما من صاحب ذهب ولا فضة لا يؤدي زكاته أو لا يؤدي زكاتها إلا صفحت له بصفائح من نار يوم القيامة يكوى بها جنبه وظهره، كلما بردت أحميت عليه في يوم كان مقداره 50,000 سنة، كلما بردت أحميت عليه في يوم كان مقداره 50,000 سنة. قال ثم يرى سبيله إلى الجنة أم إلى النار، ثم يرى سبيله إما إلى الجنة وإما إلى النار. هذا يدل إما إلى الجنة وإما إلى النار، دليل على عدم كفره، لأن لو كان كافرا بمجرد الترك لما كان إلا النار ثم يؤخذ إلى النار، ما فيها، لأن الجنة محرمة على الكفار. استدل العلماء بهذا الحديث على أن تارك الزكاة ليس جحودا فإنه لا يعد من الكفار، ولا شك أنه آثم وتبقى في عنقه في ذمته، وإذا تاب فإنه يجب أن يخرج لجميع السنين التي ذهبت منه.
And then the author rahimahullah says, as for the zakat, if he perform it and give it, it's accepted from him with the sin being sinful by preventing those who deserve it from benefiting from that zakat. He says, as for the zakat, we know that this is one of the pillars of Islam. But if a person, for example, delayed his zakat, which is a sin, unless if that person have a valid reason, valid excuse for delaying it and not giving it to those who deserve it, such as the poor and the needy and the like, in the time that is fixed by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For example, Allah tells us in the Quran, and when you harvest, at the moment of the time of the harvest, you give the zakat that is due from that which Allah has given you, subhanahu wa ta'ala. He says, the adilla, the proofs, as related to the one who does not give the zakat, of course, now we're not talking about the one who, once again, see it's halal for him, permissible not to give the zakat, because that's kufr al-'iyadu billah. But the one who does not see it that way is not a kafir, but he's sinful, wal-'iyadu billah. The dalil is what came in the hadith in Sahih Muslim, that the Prophet ﷺ said there is not a person who possess gold or silver and did not pay the zakat in this life, except that gold and silver will be heated in Yawm al-Qiyamah, in the fire of hellfire, and he will be branded by those things in his sides and his back. Whenever they become cold, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make them heated again, and this punishment will be continuous in a day that is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala equal 50,000 years. Then after that person will see his way, whether to the Jannah, whether to the hellfire. So this is one of the proof that the ulama, they says, the one who does not pay the zakat, he's not a disbeliever. Unless if he make istihlal, thing that is not permissible, or he doesn't have to pay the zakat because this is not lawful to give the zakat, it's not wajib to give the zakat and the like. He says, because if the one who does not pay the zakat is considered a disbeliever, the Prophet ﷺ would not say he will see his way after all this punishment to the Jannah, or rather it's going to be he's going to go to the hellfire. Because the kafir, he doesn't have a portion in the Jannah. He won't be admitted to the Jannah. So he says, so therefore, the one who does not pay the zakat, of course, that's a sin, because he's depriving those who deserve it to get it in the time that is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has set for them to get it. So he's a sinful. But if that person, for example, repents in this life and know that what he was doing or she was doing wrong, then with that repentance, they have to pay all of the previous year they didn't give the zakat for. All of them together. Now.
ولا يستدل بقتال أبي بكر رضي الله عنه لمانع الزكاة بأنهم كفار. لا يستدل بهذا. والذي قاتلهم أبو بكر رضي الله عنه ليسوا كلهم فقط منعوا الزكاة، بل هناك من ارتد منهم. وقد ذكر الخطابي في معالم السنن في شرح سنن أبي داود، ذكر أصنافا ممن قاتلهم أبو بكر رضي الله عنه وأنهم كانوا قد اجتمعوا عليه يريدون يعني منهم من أراد القتال، ومنهم من ارتد، ومنهم من منع الزكاة، فقاتلهم جميعا، ولكن قتاله للمرتدين لكفرهم وقتاله لمانع الزكاة لخروجهم عليه لأنهم خرجوا عليه وما رضوا أن يعطوه، وقال والله لا، لو قاتلن من فرق بين الصلاة والزكاة، لأن هذا خروج على ولي الأمر، خروج على ولي الأمر، أراد أن يأخذ منهم فأبوا، فقاتلهم قتال البغاة، كما أن ولي الأمر يقاتل البغاة الذين يبغون عليهم وهم يعني ليسوا كفار، يقاتلون ويجوز له أن يقاتلهم، وإذا بويع لخليفتين فاقتلوا الآخر منهما ولا يدل على كفره، فكذلك ليس كل قتال يدل على كفر أما من يقاتل، فلا يستدل بهذا على كفر تارك الزكاة، مع أن هناك أدلة صريحة وصحيحة بعدم كفره إن كان غير مستحل لتركه.
نعم. He says, now here's the point. We shouldn't understand that from the story or what the incident that took place in the time of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, when he was the Khalifa and he's the first Khalifa of the Muslimin after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam death. He says we should not understand that because he did fight and he fought against those who prevent the zakat. We do not understand from that those who prevent the zakat, they were disbelievers. Because those who abstained from giving the zakat to Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, they were only one group from many others who he fought against. Because, for example, there are certain people who apostated too, from those that he fought against them. Aynam. And there are those who they gathered to fight Abu Bakr. And there are those who they didn't give the zakat. As Al-Khattabi rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentioned in his book, the explanation of Sunan Abi Dawood, that these people that Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, with the Sahaba, they fought against them, they were different groups. Some from them, those who actually they were preparing to fight Abu Bakr and the Sahaba. And from them, those who actually they left Islam, they apostated. And it is from them those who abstained from giving the zakat. So he fought all of these people together, not only those who didn't give the zakat. So those who abstained from giving the zakat now, so they were going against the ruler, the Khalifa of the Muslimin. They abstained from giving the zakat to him, because the zakat should be given to those people who are assigned by the ruler, by the Khalifa, to collect the zakat. They abstain. But these are people are bughats, renegades. They go against the ruler, so they are not considered as disbelievers. Likewise, another example he says of the bughat, those who go against the ruler and to be fought for that reason. If there is an established ruler, but then the people, they want to elect another ruler. So they should fight the other ruler. He said, not even when you see, for example, Muslim ruler fighting certain people and certain... it's not always because they are kuffar. It's not because of they are kuffar. In this case here, some of them, yes, they apostated al-iyadu billah. But when it comes to those who prevent the zakat, the correct opinion that is taken from the adilla, that they are not kuffar. They are not fought against because they are kuffar, unless if they, once again, as we now we know, they consider it to be lawful not to give the zakat, but because they went against the ruler. Naam.
ثم قال رحمه الله تعالى في آخر الأركان قال وأما الحج فمن وجب عليه ووجد السبيل إليه ووجب عليه ولا يجب عليه في عامة ذلك حتى لا يكون له منه بد ثم أداه كان مؤديا ولم يكن آثما في تأخيره إذا أداه. الحج لا شك أنه ركن من أركان الإسلام وأنه يجب على الإنسان مرة في العمر, يجب على الإنسان مرة في العمر. ومن وجد إلى ذلك سبيلا, الذي لا يجد إلى ذلك سبيلا يسقط عنه. ومن ذلك قالوا السبيل الزاد والراحلة, الزاد والراحلة. وقيل أيضا أمن الطريق, أمن الطريق. وزادوا أيضا المحرم للمرأة, فإنها إذا ما كان لها محرم فإنها لا يلزمها الحج. فمن أدى, من وجد السبيل إلى ذلك ومتى أداه كان مؤديا. وهذا على القول بأن الحج لا يجب على الفور وإنما يجب على التراخي, وهو أرجح أقوال العلماء, لا يجب على الفور وإنما يجب على التراخي, يجب على التراخي. يعني يجوز تأجيل الحج إلى السنة المقبلة, السنة التي بعده وإن كنت مستطيعا, لكنه لا يجب على الفور. قال متى أداه كان مؤديا ولم يكن آثما. ما هو مثل الصلاة لها وقت, رمضان له وقت, صوم. ولم يكن آثما في تأخيره إذا أداه. هذا مبني على مسألة فقهية, وهي هل يجب على الفور أو يجب على التراخي. قال كما كان آثما بالزكاة. لماذا آثما بالزكاة؟ لأن الزكاة وآت حقه يوم حصاده, لابد أن يؤدى في وقته. لأن الزكاة حق للمسلمين مساكين, حق لمسلمين مساكين حبسه عليهم, فكان آثما حتى وصل إليه. ولأنه يجب أيضا, يجب إذا قام يعني داعيه, لأن العلة, لأن الحكم يدور مع علته, الحكم يدور مع علته نفيا وإثباتا. إذا وجدت العلة وجد الحكم, وجد المال المزكى عليه وجد الزكاة. فالحج ما يجب عليك إلا مرة في العمر, ما هو مباشرة بعد البلوغ, ما يلزم بعد البلوغ مباشرة, وإنما مرة في العمر وأن تكون مستطيعا. فرق بين الزكاة والحج. ثم قال وأما الحج فكان فيما بينه وبين ربه, إذا أدى فقد أدى. وهذا أيضا على أنه للتراخي, وهو أيضا حق يعني بينك وبين ربك خلاف الزكاة. يعني يريد أن يبين أن الزكاة أمرها أعظم, ولا شك لأن الزكاة فيه نفع غير, نفع الغير, وما كان منفعته متعدية فهو أعظم. ولذلك الشيخ بن باز رحمه الله تعالى لما سئل أيهما أفضل, حج النافلة أم الصدقة, قال الصدقة. الصدقة يعني عندك مال تريد تحج, ولكن حجك نافلة. وهناك أناس يحتاجون و تعطيهم أم تذهب للحج؟ الصدق أفضل من الحج، من حج النافلة. الصدق أفضل، لأن كلما كان متعديا ونفعه يعني ليس قاصرا عليه كان أفضل، كان أفضل. ولذلك يتمنى العبد أن يعود فيتصدق. يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تلهكم أموالكم ولا أولادكم عن ذكر الله ومن يفعل ذلك فأولئك هم الخاسرون. ولا نعم وأنفقوا مما رزقناكم من قبل أن يأتي أحدكم الموت فيقول إيش ربي قال لو أخرتني إلى أجل قريب فأصدق وأعمل صالحا وأكون من الصالحين. أي نعم قال نعم يا أيها الذين آمنوا لا تلهكم أموالكم ولا أولادكم عن ذكر الله ومن يفعل ذلك فأولئك هم الخاسرون. وأنفقوا مما رزقناكم من قبل أن يأتي أحدكم الموت فنعم فيقول ربي لولا أخرتني إلى أجل قريب فأصدق وأكون من الصالحين ولن يؤخر الله نفسا إذا جاء أجلها والله خبير بما تعملون. فعموما قالوا فأصدق، لماذا؟ لأنه رأى عظيم أجر الصدقة، لأنه رأى عظيم أجر الصدقة. ولذلك قال النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم والصدقة برهان، صدقة برهان. فعموما نعم. ثم قال وإن هو مات، أيضا ختم هذه الرسالة بقوله وإن هو مات وهو واجد مستطيع ولم يحج. إذا هو مات، هذا الذي ما حج مات وهو مستطيع ولم يحج، سأل الرجعة إلى الدنيا أن يحج، وهذا يدخل في وأن أعمل صالحا، يعني من الآية التي جاء قال ربي ارجعون لعلي أعمل صالحا فيما تركت. نعم أعمل صالحا، فقالوا أعمل صالحا يعني جميع ما ترك من الأعمال الصالحة. وقيل أيضا حتى المحسن والصالح والرجل الصالح يقول هذا الكلام لما يرى من يعني نفع هذه الأعمال، وأيضا يرى من مكانتها عند الله عز وجل. قال أن يحج ويجب لأهله أن يحج عنه، يجب على أهله ويجب لأهله أن يحج عنه. وهذا يجب على أهله إذا كان إيش؟ إذا كان ترك مالا، إذا كان ترك مالا فإنه يجب عليهم أن يحجوا عن، يخرجون من هذا المال الحج عن، كما جاء في الحديث الصحيح أن امرأة أو أن يعني امرأة نعم جاءت إلى النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قالت يا رسول الله إن أمي ماتت ولم تحج أفأحج عنها؟ قال لها رأيت لو كان على أمك دين هل أنت قاضي؟ قالت نعم. قال وكذلك دين الله فإنه أولى، دين الله أولى، أو كما قال صلى الله عليه وسلم. فإذن يجب لأهله إذا كان ترك مالا فإنه يخرج قبل أن يقسم بين الورثة، يخرج ما يكون متعلق بالحج، مثل يخرج أيضا ما كان متعلق بالكفن والدفن والدين، هذه قبل الإرث، كل هذه نعم والوصية في الثلث، هذا كله يخرج قبل الإرث وقبل تقسيم المال. لكنه لو أنه قال نعم، ونرجو أن يكون ذلك مؤديا عنه، كما لو كان عليه دين فقضي عنه بعد موته. لكن لو أنه ما ترك مالا فهل يجب على ورثته؟ لا يجب. لو أنه ما ترك مالا فإنه لا يجب، وإنما يستحب، كما أن الصيام عنه أيضا يستحب ولا يجب، وقضاء الدين أيضا يستحب إذا ما ترك مالا ولا يجب. ولا شك أنهم يعني هذا من الإحسان إلى الميت، ويعني الأقربون أولى بالمعروف. وبهذا يكون المصنف رحمه الله تعالى أنهى هذه الرسالة بحمد الله تعالى. ونسأل الله عز وجل أن ينفعنا بما سمعنا وما قرأنا، وأن يرحم أن يرحمنا وأن يرحم هذا الإمام الحميدي رحمه الله تعالى، وأن يرحم مشايخنا، وأن يغفر لنا ولهم، وأن يوفقنا وإياكم. وأسأل الله عز وجل أن يوفق القائمين على هذا المسجد وعلى مساجد أهل السنة في كل مكان وأن يسر أمرهم وأن يجعلنا وإياهم مفاتيح خير مغالق شر إنه ولي ذلك والقادر عليه وصلى الله وسلم وبارك وأنعم على نبيه محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين.
إن الإمام الحميدي رحمه الله تعالى he concluded this by when he mentioned the pillars of Islam he says as for the Hajj since it is something that is a right that is between him and between his Lord if he perform it alhamdulillah whenever he perform it but if he died And then he's going to mention this, inshallah ta'ala, he break it down and he explain a portion by a portion. He says, Hajj, no doubt, it is one of the pillars of Islam. And it is obligatory upon the person once in his lifetime or her lifetime. But with certain conditions, it is mentioned for those who have the ability to do so. If they are not able, then they are exempt from performing Hajj. So the ulama, they mentioned from the things that qualify a person to be able is to have enough provisions to sustain himself during this beautiful journey and the ride to get there, the mount to get there. Also, some of them added that the path has to be secure. No fighting, no highway robbers. He's not afraid for himself and his life and his wealth and his family and the like. And as for the woman, there is another condition that she should have the mahram. If the woman does not have a mahram, even though she has the money and all that, it is not incumbent upon her to make hajj. So if anyone have these conditions, whenever they make hajj, and this is according to the soundest of the opinions of the ulama, that it will be accepted from them. Meaning, that is not obligatory to make hajj immediately whenever you have the means together. But rather, they says, عَلَى التَّرَاخِي, meaning, even if a person this year have all the means to make it, but he choose to delay it to the next year, he says, according to the soundest opinion of the ulama, yes, it's okay. It's okay. It's not like the zakat. The zakat, if a person delay it, says, look, I'm just going to give it next year, now it does a sin. Why? Because when a person make hajj, it's for himself. But when a person prevents the zakat, so he preventing the people from a right that is due to them. Okay? So, he says this will bring us to something that is very important. Naam. That the zakat, as we mentioned, for example, for those who they harvest, at the moment of the harvest, they should give that which Allah has made obligatory upon them to give. But the hajj, it is made obligatory once in a lifetime for those who have the ability to do so. He says, and that's also the difference between Hajj and the Zakat. Why the one who delayed the Hajj is not sinful and the one who delayed the Zakat it is? Because Hajj is between you and your Lord. You benefit from it. Zakat actually is extra. Yes, you will benefit, but there are other people that will benefit. So therefore there is a qaida ruling whatever an action that benefits you but also muta'addi and naf' muta'addi meaning it goes beyond you it will benefit others that is better for you that is better that action is better for this Sheikh Ibn Baz rahimahullah ta'ala he was asked what is better for a person to do a person has already made hajj that is wajib he wants to make hajj that is nafil preparatory act of hajj but there are certain people who need the money should he use that money to go and make the hajj that is not wajib, or give it to those people as a charity. Says yes, to give the charity, it's better than that person go and make the hajj that is not wajib upon him, that's just nafil. He said this is if he have, for example, that money, whether to use it for hajj or sadaqah. He said if a person have more money for both, Of course, what's better here, give the sadaqah and go for hajj. He said, for example, here, you want to make hajj, but there are people that are in need, and if that's all you have, it's better for you to give those people and help them. Alhamdulillah, that's for the hajj that is not obligatory upon you, the nafil. He said, subhanAllah, this is amazing. when it comes to doing good and try to understand this matter, to give precedence to what's even better for you from the actions you be having, that fiqh, that sound understanding. When you face with a choice, you do this act of worship, which is good, this is another one. How do you understand which one you choose? This is very important. He says, that's why you will have ayats in the Quran, that the people who, when they die, they will wish to go back and give charity. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us in the end of Surah Al-Munafiqun, O you, ya ayyuha alladhina amanu, O you have believed, let not your wealth nor your children divert you away from the remembrance of Allah. And whoever does such things, such are the losers, al-khasirun. And spend from that which we have given you before a day come and one of you will, to the end of the, you know the ayats, inshallah, you got the Bible Quran. Now, so here he says this is the proof, alhamdulillah, that these people, they wish to go back to give sadaqah because of the fadl, subhanAllah, because of the great virtue and great rewards of the sadaqah. And the Prophet ﷺ, he says that the sadaqah is a sign of iman of a person. The person who gives sadaqah and charity is a sign of iman and a proof of his iman. Then Imam al-Humaydi rahimahullah ta'ala, he says, if a person died while they were able to make hajj, but they didn't hajj, they didn't make hajj, naam, still this person, they will hope if they die to come back and make hajj. Why? Because this is from the actions. When a person dies and he sees the great reward that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared for those who do these righteous actions, people, they will, those who were negligent, they will hope if they can come back and do those actions. He said, even those who were righteous and they did good, they will hope if they can come back and do even more of these righteous actions, because they know the great reward that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has prepared for such people. Now, if a person died and didn't make hajj, the Shaykh here, Imam al-Humaydi, in the book of Aqidah, he says, it is obligatory upon the inheritors, the people he left behind, his family, to make hajj on his behalf. Shaykh, he says this, if he has money, the tariqa. If he left money, then they take from it that which they use to make hajj on his behalf. He says, and this is permissible in Islam, the hajj al-badal, to make hajj on behalf of somebody else, especially the family members. We have a hadith, sound hadith, a woman came to the Prophet ﷺ and she said, O Messenger of Allah, her mother, she died, but she didn't make the hajj al-wajib, that was obligatory. The Prophet ﷺ, she said, shall I perform hajj on her behalf? The Prophet ﷺ said, do you see if your mother left a deen, a debt that she didn't settle before she died, would you pay it on her behalf? She said, yes. She said, this is the deen of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It's more worthy to take care of. So before if a person died while they have the ability to make hajj and they didn't, so the heirs, the inheritors, before they divide his wealth, they should take in consideration certain things. From them is this, to take from that money to perform hajj on behalf of such a person. Likewise, to take from the money to buy the kafan, the shrouding and whatever is needed to bury him according to the sunnah. And also the deen, if that person have any debts, they have to be taken away. Also the wasiyah, if this person has left a will, which is no more than a third. All of these things has to be taken first before the people start listening, what is my right, what is mine, and portion of it. Now, but if a person now, he says, did not leave any money, it's not obligatory upon the inheritors to come together and put money together to perform hajj on his behalf, but he become recommended. The same way for fasting. If a person died and the like and didn't make the fasting, the likewise the deen, if a person has a debt, but they die and they didn't leave no money to pay for that debt, then he become mustahab, recommended for the people, especially his family, because the family members, this if they do this, this is shows good for the deceased person and the closest people to you. They are more worthy of your good. He says, this is how Imam al-Humaydi has finished and completed this risala of Aqidah. So we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make it a beneficial these sessions for all of us. Amen. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala have mercy on us. and on this great Imam Al-Humayri and all of the Mashayikh, our Mashayikh, all of us and you, Ameen. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant tawfiq and success to the people who are in charge of this masjid that is established upon the Sunnah and all of the masajid that is established upon the Sunnah of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from those who are keys to all good. They are and to open all doors of good and to close all doors of evil. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala Muhammad ala Muhammad.